let's study about the human digestive system. The human digestive system comprises of a 9-meter long alimentary canal with associated digestive glands. The digestive system of the alimentary canal starts with the mouth and ends with the anus. The various parts of the alimentary canal are mouth cavity, esophagus or food pipe, stomach, small intestine, which is around 6 meters long. Yesterday I had told you that the length of the small intestine varies in different animals. In carnivores, the length of the small intestine is smaller because they feed on meat, whereas herbivores have got a longer small intestine because they have to eat a lot of plant matter, and so as they have to digest cellulose, they have a longer small intestine. In human beings, the small intestine has around 6 meters long. The small intestine leads to the large intestine, which is divided into 3 parts, that is cecum, colon and the rectum. And the rectum opens to exterior by means of anus, the opening of anus is guarded by a ring of sphincter muscle, which is called as anal sphincter. Now let us study what happens in different parts as the food passes. Now the mouth, as yesterday I had told you, that mouth is a horizontal slit which is guarded by upper and lower lip, and the jaws in the mouth cavity, upper and lower jaws, have teeth which is used for mastication or chewing of food. The floor of the mouth cavity, mouth leads to the mouth cavity, and this floor has got a muscular tongue which has got various functions to perform, like it helps in speaking, it helps in mixing the food thoroughly with saliva, then the tongue helps in pushing the food towards the teeth so that the food can be properly chewed, and finally it makes the food like a bolus, that is a ball, and then it pushes the food into the esophagus. The mouth cavity, opening in the mouth cavity are 3 pairs of salivary glands which release a digestive juice called as saliva, right? Now let's see what happens. Like when you take in food through the mouth, the food reaches the mouth, and in the mouth both physical and chemical digestion starts. Now physical digestion is brought about by mastication. Physical digestion is brought about by mastication, that is chewing. The teeth helps in chewing the food and breaking the food into smaller particles. This is required for increasing the activity or efficiency of the enzymes. The mouth, opening in the mouth are 3 pairs of salivary glands. They secrete a digestive juice called as saliva. Now the saliva has got an enzyme. It has the enzyme named salivary amylase. The salivary amylase is a starch digesting enzyme. So what happens is, when as you are chewing the food in the mouth, the starch which is present in the food will be acted upon by salivary amylase, and it is broken down to sugar called as maltose. Not entire of the starch, a small amount of starch, maybe 20-30% of the starch, is converted to maltose or sugar. This is the reason why when you chew bread for a certain period of time without like mixing it with anything else, after some time you find that the bread or the piece of roti starts tasting sweet, because the starch present in that will be converted to sugar. Now after this, what happens is, after you have properly chewed the food, from the tongue is going to make this into a bolus, and then after converting it into a bolus, the tongue pushes the food into the esophagus. From here, now the food is to be is passed to the next part of the digestive system, that is called as a stomach. One more very important thing is that this mouth cavity leads to an area. This particular area is called as pharynx. Okay, this is a common opening for both mouth cavity and nasal cavity. Below you have got the mouth cavity, which has tongue and all the other teeth and all, and above this mouth cavity there is nasal cavity present, through which air passes. So both nasal cavity and the mouth cavity opens into a common passage, which is called as a pharynx. And pharynx has got 2 openings. One opening will lead to the windpipe, about which you'll be learning in respiration topic, and the other opening leads to the food pipe. This opening of the food pipe is called as gullet. Now this food pipe, food is pushed into this food pipe. The bolus is pushed into the food pipe by the tongue, and from here this bolus or the ball of food has to move down to the stomach. The wall of the esophagus does not contain any digestive enzyme. So there's no digestive juice push poured by this wall. Rather, the activity of salivary amylase will continue. Okay, as just now I have told you, the digestion begins in the mouth. So both physical digestion is brought by the teeth, whereas chemical digestion is brought about by the salivary amylase, which converts the starch present in the food into sugar. Now from here, from the esophagus, the food is going to go down to the stomach, and this is brought about by a type of movement called as peristalsis, because there's this here, there's nothing, we don't take any like the food has to go down, and there is no other means of pushing the food down. So here what there is a special type of movement that starts, which is called as peristalsis. This is brought about by the involuntary or the smooth muscles which forms the wall of the esophagus. You can just have a look at this picture. Peristalsis is a wave of contraction and relaxation that occurs all along the digestive tract, and this will help the food to be pushed down. Now what happens in peristalsis is, once the food has gone into the esophagus, the smooth muscles or the involuntary muscles which are present above the esophagus, they will contract, whereas the muscle which is present below the bolus or the food will relax. So because of the contraction over here, the food is going to be pushed forward. Now once the food has reached at this particular point, the previous muscle which had contracted will relax. The muscle above the, now the muscle which is present above the food again will contract. The muscle which is present below the food will relax, and again the food will be pushed down. So in this way, with the wave of contraction and relaxation that occurs rhythmically, the food is brought ultimately to the base, and from here the food is pushed into the stomach. Remember that at the junction of esophagus and the stomach, again there is a ring of muscle present. This ring of muscle is called as esophageal sphincter. The function role of it is that normally this esophageal sphincter will be present in a contracted condition. So jab tak ye contracted hai, there won't be any opening. But then once the bolus has reached here, this will relax. As it relaxes, this will create an opening, and the bolus or the food is pushed into the stomach. So from once the food has reached the stomach, now the further process begins. Now the wall of the stomach has got involuntary muscles, so they will contract, relax powerfully, and that will cause the food to be properly churned. The inner wall of the muscle, has got many glands called as the gastric glands. The inner wall of the stomach has got numerous glands called as the gastric glands, and these gastric glands release a juice which is called as gastric juice. The gastric juice has got three important components. Let us see what are those three important components. So these three important components are, the gastric juice has got three important components. They are hydrochloric acid, mucus, and a protein digesting enzyme called as pepsin. Let us study the function of each. Now one more thing is, once the food has reached the stomach, this gastric juice will already be present in the stomach. So the food, when the inner the muscles present in the inner wall, when they contract and relax, the food is properly or thoroughly mixed up with the gastric juice, and now the components of gastric juice come into action. So let us see what are the functions of each of the component. Hydrochloric acid has got two important functions to perform. First is to make the food acidic. This is required for the protein digesting enzyme pepsin to act. This will become active only when the food is acidic, and when the food is present in the mouth, the food is almost alkali, like it's almost neutral, because saliva is almost neutral. So once the food has reached stomach, it has to turn acidic, and that is done by hydrochloric acid. In addition to this, the hydrochloric acid also kills the germs which are present in the food. Next important component of this gastric juice is mucus. The mucus lines the inner wall of the stomach. The inner wall of the stomach has got a coating, a thick coating of mucus. And why is this required? This is required for protecting the inner wall from the corrosive action of hydrochloric acid. Hydrochloric acid, it's acid. And since it is an acid, it will be highly corrosive. The inner wall may burn. And so to protect it, the inner wall is coated by a thick layer of mucus, right? And apart from this, the mucus is also going to protect the inner wall of the stomach from the action of pepsin. Pepsin is a protein digesting enzyme. And the entire stomach is made up of tissues, and tissues are made up of proteins. So they may also get affected. So the mucus role is to protect the inner wall of the stomach from the corrosive action of hydrochloric acid and pepsin. The third important component present in the food is pepsin. Let us start. The third component present in gastric juice, it's not the food, is pepsin. And this is a protein digesting enzyme which helps in digestion of proteins which are present in the food. Pepsin helps in digesting proteins in the acidic medium. This acidic medium is provided by hydrochloric acid, which is also a component of gastric juice. So proteins present in the food is acted upon by the enzyme. This is an enzyme, a protein digesting enzyme. So it's acted upon by pepsin, and the proteins are broken down to peptones and proteases. Try to recall, you have learned that proteins are the polymers of amino acid. These are polymers of amino acid. This you have learned in your junior classes, right? So these proteins, which are polymers of amino acids, are broken down into smaller chains of amino acids, which are termed as peptones and proteoses. So after, this is the entire process, and this entire process in the stomach will take around 3 to 4 hours, after which the partially digested food will be almost like a semi-fluid. And now from the stomach, this food which is partially digested, it's not completely digested, the partially digested food in small amount is going to go to the next part of the digestive tract, which is called as a small intestine. The small intestine the first part of the small intestine, it is called as this part. This is called as a duodenum. It's called as a duodenum. Now, it's not that the entire of the partially digested food from the stomach is going to go into the duodenum. Food goes in small amounts. And like how I had told you that there is a esophageal sphincter present at the junction of esophagus and stomach, there's another sphincter muscle present between the stomach and the duodenum. So this allows only smaller amount of digested food, partially digested food, into the duodenum. Now, opening in the duodenum are two glands. These two glands are liver, which is the largest gland present in the body, and the pancreas. Just below the stomach, there is a pancreas, and liver is present on the right side. Now, the function of liver is to secrete a digestive juice, which is called as bile. Liver secretes bile, and bile is temporarily stored in gallbladder, which is a sac-like structure, okay, attached to the liver. So liver secretes bile, and bile is temporarily stored in the gallbladder, right? Now pancreas, it is called as a heterocrine gland. It is both exocrine and endocrine in nature. Exocrine because it releases a digestive juice called as pancreatic juice. And its endocrine role is to release a hormone called as insulin. This is a hormone about which you'll be learning in control and coordination topic. So the digestive role of pancreas is to release pancreatic juice. Look here, pancreas secretes pancreatic juice, and that is taken by a duct. This duct, it is called as the pancreatic duct. So this duct will take this pancreatic juice to the duodenum. Liver secretes bile. stored temporarily in gallbladder, and from here the bile duct will carry the bile to the duodenum. At one point, both the pancreatic duct and the bile duct join, and through this common duct, these juices are poured over here. Now, these juices now come into action. So, let us study about the function of these juices. Let us study first about the bile. Bile is we will not say it as an enzyme or a digestive juice, because bile does not contain any enzyme. This does not contain any enzyme, but despite it has got no enzyme, bile is very important for digestion of food. How it is important, let us study. Now, as already I have told you, when the food from the stomach, when it is reaching the duodenum, it is like fluid. So here, when the food reaches the stomach, the duodenum, the fat which is present, because the food is like a fluid. So just have a look at this picture. This is a part of this duodenum with liver and pancreas. So here the food is like a semi-fluid, and here the fat fat will be present in the form of a droplets. They'll be present as droplets, like how you just, if you take a glass of water and put some oil in it, they'll be like droplets. So similarly, the fat which is present in the food, it will be in the form of droplets, not been digested yet. Now here, what does the bile do is that these droplets, which are quite big enough to be digested, they will be acted upon by bile. How it is acted upon? Let us study. Now the bile has got bile salts in it. These bile salts, what they do is they will be acting upon the large fat droplets which are present in the partially digested food. So they act upon the large fat droplets and break them into smaller droplets of fat. This process of breaking down of large droplets of fat into smaller droplets of fat is called as emulsification of fat. This is called as emulsification of fat. So bile, first important role of bile is to emulsify the fat. Bile emulsifies the fat, and this is very much required for, as it increases the efficiency of pancreatic lipase. Lipase is a fat digesting enzyme. It is a fat digesting enzyme. So this efficiency, when it's like, if it is larger droplet, the enzyme will be only acting on the surface. But when the droplets are broken into small droplets, the total surface area is increasing for the activity of lipases. This is one role. Other role of bile is to make the food alkaline. Try to recall, I told you that when the stomach, the food is acidic, and that's because of hydrochloric acid. Once the food has reached duodenum, the food has to be alkaline. This is required for the activity of the enzyme trypsin. Trypsin is a pancreatic enzyme. It is again a protein digesting enzyme present in pancreatic juice. So for trypsin to act, because trypsin will become active only when the food is alkaline, food is made alkaline by bile. So bile has got two important functions to perform. One is to make the food alkaline, that is, the acidic nature of the food will be converted to alkaline nature by bile, and other is to emulsify the fat, which is to break the larger droplets of fat present in the food into smaller droplets. Okay, so these are the two functions of bile. Now let us study about the pancreatic juice. Now pancreas, here pancreas, it's present below the stomach. I've already shown you the diagram earlier. Just below the stomach, there is pancreas present. Pancreas secretes a digestive juice called as the pancreatic juice. Now, pancreatic juice has got, it contains three important enzymes. One is trypsin. Trypsin is a protein digesting enzyme. Other is pancreatic lipase, which will be digesting the fat present. And there is pancreatic amylase. So let's study about each one by one. Trypsin, as I said you, it is a protein digesting enzyme. So once the food has become alkaline, in alkaline medium, the proteins which could not be digested by pepsin, the peptones and proteases, these are the partially digested proteins, these all are acted upon by trypsin in alkaline medium, and they are broken down into still smaller chains of amino acid, which are called as peptides. Peptides will be small chains of amino acids having 2 to 3 amino acids in them. So trypsin in alkaline medium converts the proteins, peptones and proteases into small chains of amino acids. That is, it brings about a further digestion of proteins in the duodenum. There is pancreatic lipase also present. Pancreatic lipase, which is it digests the emulsified fat. Look here, fat I said you, bile salts break the larger droplets of fat into smaller droplets. So these emulsified fats are acted upon by pancreatic lipase and they are digested to fatty acids and glycerol. Okay, so digestion of fat is done by lipases, which is an enzyme present in pancreatic juice. Bile only breaks the larger droplets of fat into smaller droplets. So a question generally comes in examination as bile does not contain any enzyme, but still it is important for digestion of food. So what the role of bile is to break the fat into smaller droplets. That's own, but that's not chemical digestion. Chemical digestion of fat is, it starts with pancreatic lipase. So they digest the fat. Some of the fat which is present, emulsified fat, is broken down to the simplest form, fatty acids and glycerol. Okay, so that is done. And finally, the third important component present in pancreatic juices, pancreatic amylase, which acts upon the partially digested starch, carbohydrates, and they bring about further digestion. So further digestion of these carbohydrates, complex carbohydrates, is done by the pancreatic amylase. Now from here, like once the food is digested, not completely, partially digested, from here the food is going to move into the next part of the digestive tract, which is the small intestine. This is a place where complete digestion of food occurs. So in this part, complete digestion of food takes place. And how it is done? It is because the small intestine walls also contain a lot of digestive glands which secrete digestive juice called as intestinal juice. The intestinal juice has all the enzymes which will bring about complete digestion. So complete digestion of food is brought about by the enzymes which are present in intestinal juice. That is, what do they, these enzymes do? They'll break down the peptides or proteins which were not earlier digested to amino acids. The carbohydrates will be finally broken down to glucose or simple sugars. Any kind of fat that is left over will be finally digested by the different types of lipases present into fatty acids and glycerol. So finally, in the small intestine, digestion is completed. And after digestion is completed in the small intestine, next step of holozoic nutrition is absorption. So that is also done in the small intestine. So now let us study how this is brought about in the small intestine. Okay, let us just see this part. In the first, this first part is a duodenum where the bile and the pancreatic juice will act. Then the second part of small intestine, complete digestion occurs. And in the third part, the absorption of food will occur. And this is aided by those finger-like projections present in the inner wall of small intestine. Let's study about the absorption of food.